Hello and welcome. My name is LaikaDream. I am hosting your featured Dragon Lord. This week, we have PrimeMusashi with us. I am going to let him introduce himself. He does have a YouTube channel, and I do have the link to share it with you right now. So to learn some pretty awesome stuff that he is an expert on, make sure to check out his channel. Let me pause my music. All right, hello.
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 How are you?
I'm fabulous. How are you?
Doing well, thanks.
So you are PrimeMusashi. What team are you currently on, and what league is that in?
I'm on Angels and Demons. I believe we're currently in Sapphire 3, but we move around quite a bit.
Awesome, awesome. So how long have you been playing War Dragons now?
So I took a long break. I started in 2015, and I took a break probably of almost 2 years, if I had to guess, a year and a half, 2 years. And then I ended up just deciding to download the game again, because I guess I missed it. So it took a little while, but came back.
Long break, little while, came back. What originally drew you to the game, and then what made you want to come back after taking such a long break?
So I like games like this, where you're like building stuff up gradually over time. I played Clash of Clans, back in the day, and, I was looking for something different, that was sort of on the same path, more or less, and, I stumbled on this somehow in the app store.
I played that game for a hot minute as well. I would say the graphics and stuff in War Dragons is quite a bit, like, a whole different level.
Yeah, it's pretty different.
So, how did you originally, just find it looking around for a game after, like, finding that you liked games with other people and destroying bases? And you were just looking for something like that? Or how did you find War Dragons?
How did I find it? I just found it in the App Store. But, like, when I first downloaded it, I wasn't even sure exactly what it was. When I was looking for something to play, I downloaded, like, probably 10 games. I can't even remember most of them. But, yeah, I downloaded a bunch of them. This one, actually, like, the demo, I didn't like, so I almost didn't even try it, but I kept playing and then joined a team and really liked the aspects of flying as you progress.
That's interesting. So you didn't even like the demo?
No, I didn't like the demo. I didn't like how it seemed. So, and it's now the demos, because I just actually got a new device the other day, so I had to go back through the demo in order to get past it to do that, and it's still didn't like it. So
is it the same?
It's the same, yeah.
That's some like really good feedback to probably give them.
I don't think it changed. I could be wrong, but I don't think it changed.
That's interesting. Okay, so what would you say are like pros and cons about being on a I would say Sapphire is competitive. So like, what would you say are pros and cons about being on a competitive Sapphire team?
Pros would be better rewards. So that's very good. Like, you know, if you get on a team in Sapphire, I think they generally get the 8 out of 8 team achievement and 10 out of 10 chest quest or quest chest. So that's very helpful. Team prizes can be better. Usually the higher league that you're in, the more castles your team will have. So then that's more rewards as well. The downsides, I guess, would be if you don't want to play as much, it's going to be harder to like maintain the minimums. But that's mostly the only negative to me. But that's not a negative to me because I have time.
Totally. Completely agree. So, what are your favorite types of dragons to fly? Maybe you have more than one.
When I first started the game, I preferred actually sorcerers and warriors. And as time went on, I started realizing that hunters were a lot more strategic. And at that time, there weren't like seasonal dragons when I started. So you had just had to go up through lineage. And they were, I don't know, those dragons in the lower tiers like had uses, but there weren't a lot of dragons that could like hit up and solo bases. So it was sort of like you'd use a hunter, you'd take out mages, and then you'd follow with something else. It was more the deal there. And that's the same with like how they changed the whole war system. So like everything's sort of changing to where it's now most aspects make more sense to finish with one dragon. And so that's how it ended up using hunters more, because it wasn't really possible with defenders, or wasn't as easy with defenders, with sorcerers and warriors.
Tin Brew is saying, talk tactical to me. Can you tell us more about what tactical things you would like to know about? And we'll see what he says. So we'll just keep going until then. So, two or three favorite dragons you've had throughout your time playing War Dragons. So you said you started liking sorcerers and then you moved to hunters. So like, what are some of those favorite dragons you've had along the way?
So, let's see. My favorite dragon early on, and this wasn't super early on, but I just remember from my first stint playing the game, my favorite dragon was actually Korthanak, which was a mythic sorcerer. And he was pretty cool, like, at the time. That was probably my favorite early on. And then, let's see, since I came back, Hauhazen was one of my favorites. And now Kalivor is definitely my favorite because he's more capable. And I think it's more interesting flying Kalivor because if you win or lose, it really feels like it's based on what you did, more so than like the dragon just can or can't do it as much.
Yeah, I would totally agree with that. That's awesome. I like that dragon as well. What would you say in regards to how do you get better at flying dragons that you find are difficult? So you started with sorcerers. Were you immediately good at hunters, or did you have to like work to get better at it? And then what would you say with that for newer players who haven't either gotten good or are too intimidated to try other dragons?
So I was always okay. I wouldn't say I was great, but I was okay flying hunters off the bat, and I think the only there's a couple ways to get better flying dragons. The first way is to watch a lot of videos. So I watch like some YouTube videos and stuff like that. There's some really good flyers that put out videos, and you can learn a lot from them. And then
who would you say some of those people that put out great videos on flying are?
So Taco puts out some videos that are really good. Dad, I think, flies a lot of those really good hunter videos. And then there's some like smaller YouTubers that I wish I could remember their names off the top of my head, but they don't upload frequently, but very good flyers.
I would totally agree with you, Taco, on that one. So, yes.
And then what was there a second part to that question?
How
to get better. The other way you can get better is just by trying repeatedly. I've actually gotten like 10 times better, flying Kalivor over the last several months, just because, when I started, I was not very good and I didn't really understand how to fly him properly. I still, have a couple of weird things I do that I know I shouldn't do, but, you just get better by continuing to fly them.
Practice makes perfect, right?
Yeah, and you have to try, you have to practice two things too. You have to practice undefended, learn that, and then defended is completely different.
Totally. Especially depending on your spell colors, right? And then like shielding issues,
Yeah.
ice flak issues.
Ice flak is my biggest issue as of late. I keep getting clipped with defenders on ice flaks or by ice flaks, so.
Love and hate them, right? We love to have them,
Yeah.
hate to fly against them. Okay, so what are some of your fondest, most favorite, and/or memorable moments in general? And then, if you have anything besides that, moments that stick out that don't necessarily have to be positive, but preferably not negative.
Experiences with the game.
Yeah.
So probably the most enjoyment I've had in a long time in the game was when we conquered a T5 castle not too long ago actually. I didn't even partake in the in hitting the guards because the base was just too big for me at the time. But still it was just so exciting. That was a lot of fun, just because it all kind of happened really fast, so it was kind of just a bit of a high. And another good one, when I was a little lower level, I was on Vikings DK, and a really good team by the way. And I enjoyed sniping. I learned like attacking castles when I was there. And so I would cause a lot of trouble because I'm a very active player, and so I would cause a lot of trouble, and then those teams would come after us pretty hard, and I was the only one that was attacking them mostly. Well, it was some other people as well, but like a lot of times I would just go solo snipe, and I just repeatedly keep going until they killed me. So those would escalate into these giant things, and it was probably bad overall, but it was a lot of fun just like seeing that happen. And we got into some giant battles because of that. So that was, and I didn't know exactly what I was doing then, so I don't know, it was just a lot of fun. Most of my positive memories are Atlas memories.
Awesome. Causing lots of problems for your team, but you were getting awesome glory.
I think it actually made the team better because we kept getting like just hit really hard after I would hit these teams, and so it's actually like prompting a lot of people that weren't quite as active in Atlas to become active in Atlas, because then it was like a sort of a pride thing, like all right, these teams are hitting us really hard. And so I actually think it made the team better after doing it, as odd as that sounds.
Totally, absolutely. Learning how to defend and even just function as a team in Atlas with people attacking you. I mean, to get the experience, you have to go through it, right? Otherwise, you just don't know what you're doing, like as far as the team goes.
Yeah, and I think it was like a really good team building experience as a whole, just like grouping people together, and then we started leading some raids against those players in retaliation, and it just helps grow like the group closer together, which is obviously it, if people are playing for other people as well as themselves, they're going to be a much stronger team, because like you can only motivate yourself so much for a lot of these things. Like if it's not benefiting you directly, you really have to care about your team.
Awesome. Yes, absolutely. In regards to your YouTube channel, how long have you been doing that and how did you get started with that?
So I actually just looked. My first video, I think, was in February 2016. So I started with that. Actually, I've had quite a few YouTube channels in the past for other, like, I had a mobile game channel and some other miscellaneous channels. And so I started that because I started playing the game and there wasn't really anybody making videos. I don't know if Odin was at the time. I don't think he was, but I could be wrong. Maybe he was before me. But it was only maybe me and like one other person making War Dragons videos. So I just wanted to start that because I know I like to watch videos sometimes when I'm playing. I used to do that with Clash of Clans a lot. I would just like put on a playlist or something and watch like through a bunch of videos while I was playing just to have something in the background. And so I wanted to make some content for people, and then, you know, it was a pretty new game, so a lot of people didn't really know that much about it, and so I just wanted to like throw some of that stuff out there.
Yeah, I would say your videos are super helpful. I mean, the first one that came up when looking at your page is how to snipe castles in Atlas. That is so helpful. Like, people don't know that stuff. People, I don't know, like, especially when you're first starting the game and Atlas is just like this whole new scary world, right? So I think that you have extremely helpful videos, and I hope that people do look up your channel that don't know who you are and or haven't seen you before today, because I know we do still have lots of new people starting War Dragons, right? And all those new people do want helpful information. You know, they come to the stream saying like, how do you do this? How do you do this? So having plenty of content creators to refer people to for help is so helpful. So thank you very much.
Yeah, and it's so complex. Like, there's so much to the game, especially with Atlas. Like, there's so much to learn. I actually have been wanting to do, and I think I will do another sniping video just to update, because I've just gotten so much better at doing that since making that video.
Yeah, I look forward to seeing all the stuff you're going to put out in the future as well. I know you said you're going to be getting back to it pretty soon.
Yeah.
So when not playing War Dragons, if you don't mind, what do you like to do in your free time?
So I used to run a lot. I ran a marathon in 2018, but I don't. I haven't been running lately. I have a knee injury that I need to eventually go to the doctor for and see if I can get that figured out. But so I like to run. I'm really into computers. I like to build computers and just mess around with them.
Full marathon runner. Full marathon.
Yeah, full marathon.
That's amazing. That's amazing. And,
other than that, like, I've got a one-year-old son, so I end up taking a lot of my time there.
You have a what? Say that again.
A one-year-old son.
Oh, yeah. Congrats.
So, not a ton of free time for extra things.
Well, running and computer things and a baby. that sounds pretty full, so that's awesome. All right, so this one's a tough one. If you could only fly one dragon for the rest of your War Dragon's life, what dragon would it be? And you could say more than one, as long as you have good reasons.
So can this dragon be like a rainbow stone? Like, it's going to always be N tier?
As far as like it can evolve with you the rest of the way?
Yeah, like let's say like this isn't the case, but let's say my favorite dragon was like Druid. Could I have an end game Druid?
I would say so. I mean, okay. Maybe not changing the spells other than potentially like a spell color, right? But the spells would be the same.
Okay.
Because when they brought like Leos back, they changed one of the spells, right? To white, the only spell.
I don't recall what they changed to him. I know they didn't give his rune, and people were not happy with that. But I think it's a really tough one. I'd have to be looking at the dragons. But I'm tempted to say a sorcerer, just because at the time when I was at that level, he was so easy that it was a lot of fun. But so I would either have to go with Apophet, or Apophet, I don't know how you pronounce that, or I almost, see, I haven't flown a ton of, like, the mythics of past seasons, but I would probably, have to go with, I'd probably have to go with Hauhazen.
Awesome. Apophet was, however you say it, just like you said, was one of my favorites at that level as well. It's still my favorite to fly when, you know, the temple raid or dungeons or assault comes up. Yeah, mm-hmm. For sure. But that's awesome. And then How I was still intimidated by hunters at that time, so I've only flown HOW 2.0.
Okay.
So back
So
during the, go ahead.
I was going to say I still actually have HOW a set in my lineup.
Oh, awesome.
I don't use him very frequently these days, but if I really mess something up, sometimes it's useful.
Awesome. Everybody's very excited to see your kitty. Do you want to tell us who this is?
Yeah, this is my cat Riley.
Riley. Hi,
Yeah.
Riley.
She's apparently feeling left out.
I need attention. Aw. So, what are some things you wished you knew when you were still really early in the game?
Things I wish I knew. So probably the one thing that annoys me the most, which actually doesn't sound like that big a deal, but it annoyed me a lot at the time, or what still annoys me a lot to this day, is when I was leveling my fighter, I leveled it to level 10. So instead of being able to reduce using the trick, I can only reduce to 20,000 troops instead of 10,000, which is not as manageable a number. So for people that don't know what that is, when you have an overloaded, let's say, sieger with 80,000 troops, and you're supposed to be at your team's castles with smaller amounts of troops, you can resummon a fighter in its place, and then whatever the max capacity for the fighter is, the rest will go back to your barracks. Well, if you stop leveling the fighter at 5, you can still go to the next destroyer. And I, for whatever reason, didn't realize that, and I just leveled it up to 10. So now when I do that, I have to start from 20,000 troops instead of 10,000. So that's probably the one thing that annoys me a lot. And let's see, what else is helpful that I wish I knew? I wish I knew that how taunters worked. When I first started, I kept going to castles, and sometimes I would have to hit a taunter, and sometimes I wouldn't, and I would have no idea of knowing why that would happen. And that's because you need to load up just slightly more troops than than the largest taunter has, not taunters combined, but the largest taunter on the castle. So if there's an 8,000 troop taunter, you'd have to load 8,100 troops, and then you can hit whoever you want on that team. I did not know that, and I was very confused for a little bit on that one when I was new to Atlas. I actually played Atlas the first time around when I played, and it was completely a different Atlas when I came back, so I had to sort of relearn everything. Anything else I can think of helpful to know? Another mistake I made, hopefully people can avoid, is in Atlas lines, when you're claiming prizes, when you get to the gear, I never re realized, well, I did pretty soon, but or pretty early, but the first like two times I claimed, I didn't scroll all the way over because I was trying to claim one of the first elements. So you can slide over and then just get crafting shards, 500,000 crafting shards instead of claiming the elite gear, and it makes a lot more sense because it's going to cost you significantly less shards than if you just or if you just craft the gear and keep crafting until you get elite gear, and then you'll have more crafting shards to level it. So it makes a lot of sense, but I didn't realize that it was there to slide over.
I made that same mistake too, so that is definitely great information.
Yeah.
Will you tell us about your War Dragon's journey and what it has been like?
It's been interesting. Like the first time I played, I had a lot of fun. It was very different then. Like we were using Amarok at the time and stuff like that, mostly like in my earlier time, and that was a lot of fun. The game looked completely different when I started, and then the game sort of got boring and to me at the time, and then they introduced Atlas. And when they first introduced Atlas, it was like, I don't really remember it that well, but it was like ships. I did not care for it at all. I just thought they shouldn't have added it. And now, after coming back, like I took a break because I think I just found it frustrating because I didn't like it. And then, you know, I took a break, I came back, and then I realized now Atlas is the most fun part of the game for me. She's getting into the headphone cord. I would say that's my journey.
You're really active in Atlas. You love it.
Yeah, I could look it up. I think this month I'm at like, I don't know, I'm over 2 million kills, but I don't know exactly where.
Awesome.
It's what I have most fun doing. If they removed Atlas, it just wouldn't do anything for me. Like I'm a very competitive person, and I just like taking other people's troops.
How would you say, how did you get so knowledgeable?
Just reading forums, you know, there's a lot of great resources out there that people have worked hard building things. I've just looked over what other people have done, basically. Like, people have all sorts of interesting information, like the Reds Breeding Guide is extremely helpful. When I first started, I just was breeding everything, and you obviously spend a lot that way. I think I'm deviating. What was the question?
It was just, how did you get so knowledgeable? Which you're saying, like, basically consuming information about the game.
Yeah, just consuming information and playing. If you get on a good team, they'll teach you everything you need to know. And there's plenty of good teams that'll take low-level players, too. And you can just learn so much from those teams. Vikings DK, they took me in when I think I was a 96 or something. And, you know, they were willing to, like, teach me. Marsh Glob is the one that recruited me there. I saw her forum post, and then I joined there. And she taught me quite a bit when I joined there. That's one of the better ways to learn is just by getting on a knowledgeable team and just listening to what they have to say.
So for newer players, how do you figure out if you're on a good team or not, right? You might be thinking you're learning some stuff, but maybe you're not learning very much. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, so there's a lot of misinformation on some of the lower teams I've found. But they're still good teams. You just have to look at activity. You're not going to get on, you know, great teams. You're not going to get on Angels and Demons when you're, like, a level 50.
Right.
So you just sort of have to get on and try to get on an active team. I highly recommend that it be an Atlas team, a team with Atlas, because there's a lot of benefits to that. And the earlier you can start learning about it, the better. But that's really just look for activity. When they say, I believe it's like activity out of 100 they show for each team. You want to shoot for a team that's got as high as you can on that scale, because then there's going to be also people around. If you join some of those lower teams, some of them aren't as active, and if you join them, you'll sort of just be talking to yourself for a while. So you really have to try to find one that's like a more active team. And if you go on the War Dragons forums, there's a lot of teams looking for players that are willing to take lower level players, and if they're posting in there, they're probably going to be a little better than the average, I would say.
Right. What are your current goals in War Dragons?
Current goals. Own all castles.
Own all castles.
Yeah, I mean, I'm pretty close to my goal. My goal is to be endgame, and I'm pretty close to that now.
I know you're almost, you are like basically a level 500. You're almost there. What tier dragons are you flying?
So I'm in Verdant. I'm in the one legendary right now.
Awesome. And
this upcoming breeding, I'll breed two more legendary Verdants, and I think I'll start Lupin, the mythic, one of the mythics.
Awesome. So, I know which one that is.
Yeah.
This is just something fun. So, you said you liked, of the three dragons you liked when you were smaller in the game, which was Apophet, Hausen, right? Or was it Hauset? It's Hausen now?
Hausen now. Hauset then was probably the dragon I flew most. And then probably Korthanak, yeah.
Korthanak. Okay, so let's go with the smaller ones. So Hausen, Apophet, and Korthanak. Which would you marry? Which would you friend? Which one would you unfriend?
I would marry Hauset, and I would friend Apophet.
Oh, and you'd give up the other.
it's close. I think it's tough because I haven't flown Korthanak in so long, so I remember really liking him, but it's been so long that like I just flew Apophet and Hauset recently. Like I fly them in assault and those things, so like I think they're more like fresh, but I think back then I probably preferred Korthanak at the time.
Awesome. So if you don't mind, can I pull up your base and can you just like walk me through the thought process on your setup?
Sure, that'd be great. I actually just changed it yesterday.
Oh, awesome. All right, here is your base.
Okay, so, I'll rearrange some of the, the Ice Flak and mages up there. I just left them. I just switched from a kill on island 4 and 5 to 1 and 2. So, that was primarily an Atlas decision.
Yeah, I was going to ask, like, why? Talk to me about it.
Yeah, so Atlas, like, the whole thing is finishing your attack before the opponents finish countering you. If you're in like some of the lower ranked teams, you're not going to probably get countered as quickly. But at our rank and the opponents we face, I get countered really fast. And so if I can make them fly all the way to the end of my base to get 70%, it's going to make it so that I can land some of my attacks. So that's why I did that, because otherwise they could quit after Island 4, or maybe even before they finished 4.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, it's like, if you've got 10 good towers, your farms aren't going to add up to that much percentage.
Got you. Mine is not like this, that's why I'm asking.
Okay, yeah, no, it's just extremely beneficial. It cost me a lot of rubies to move my runes.
I was going to say, exotic runes.
Yeah, it costs like over 20,000 rubies. But I thought it was worth it because it buys me a lot more time. And, the bases I'm facing aren't like super easy bases usually. So it takes a second. And so this just helps buy me some time. So basically, unless they Crefeeble me, which is just Kralos enfeebled and run through the base really fast, I could generally finish before people because they have to get all the way to one to get 70%. Because a lot of times on counters, they will quit even before that. Like a lot of people early quit at 40%, 50% if you bring a Sieger, just to make sure that you don't land, and then they end up not losing that many troops, and they kill more than they lose, even if they stop at like 45%.
Oh.
You see that a lot at the when you're in the high, like the higher ranked Atlas teams.
Got you.
I think we're somewhere around rank. I don't know. We just moved around, I think, but we were around like rank 32 the other day.
Wow, you definitely know your stuff with Atlas then.
I like to think so.
I mean, it sounds like it.
Yeah, I mean, I learned a lot here as well. There's just a lot of I learned a lot of different attack strategies Atlas attack strategies, like Atlas raids and stuff. There's a lot of different interesting attacks and like ways you can strategize that. But as far as the base layout goes, I decided on this layout. I kind of was unsure with the dark flak versus fire flak. I have an exotic of both, and I had to choose what I wanted to use because I ultimately ended up, rightfully so, building a cosmic. So I have that back there at the front of one, and I put that on the front of one to try to pull dragons past the towers in the front, and it'll also have the effect of dragging it into the lightning super shot. I have some really good lightning runes. So those super shots, unless they bring lightning resist, do a lot of damage. The earth flak up front, obviously, is to shield the other towers and just try to make things difficult. Ice flak in the back there. I put the ice flak in the back because it's really easy to beat a base with an ice flak in the front. At least that's been my experience. And they have good range, so when towers have good range, you should take advantage of it. That's why Crystal Howitzer. I don't know, I forgot what it's called. The Crystal Howitzer and Cosmic are in the back there because they have such long range. The Ice Flak has long range, that's why I put that there. And the Dark Flak is in the front because it does not have good range at all. And so if I ever want that to fire, that's got to be in the front, because if I put it in the back, it's probably never going to touch a dragon. And it usually is the first thing killed, but I'd rather them kill it first and it have a chance to hit them if they make a mistake than just not hit them. And then a red and blue mage up front just to protect from any spells on the turn that they could use. And I have two lower level lightnings in the back. I've got like the 110 up front and then the two lowers. Ideally, it would actually be a level 110 in the front, and then, you know, the back two, one in the back would be another 110, and then the 63 would actually just be like a level one, just to give it the boost, because a level 63 is not going to do anything, and a level 99 is not really going to do anything either. But a level 110 and a level one, it would still have the boosted effect to the super shot, and it would just be another strong lightning, whereas now I've got two weaker lightnings that aren't really doing that much. But that ended up happening because I leveled them both to max several forts ago, and so I'm trying to get that other one up to current.
And then the mages with the ice flak that you still kind of have laid out on six, are you gonna move those closer to your farms?
Yeah, so I kind of want to move my farms and the fire flak out to four, and then put the mages and the ice flak on three there, because it does work on occasion. It doesn't really work against the teams that we hit very often, so that's why I haven't taken the time to move it. If I went to Allegaine a lot, I would probably get some use out of them, because I would probably clip some people in Allegaine. Generally, the flyers that hit me know how to avoid it. So that's why I haven't moved it. But I might move it and just try to get people every once in a while. If my base has, you know, two or three defenders, I can waste a few super shots trying to drain them of rage.
Anything else you want to say about your base?
No, just gear is one of the most important things with bases. I see a lot of people without good gear, and it makes a huge difference. I think I moved to 1 and 2 without gear, and I was less than 10 billion defense power because I have a full set of max mythic gear for my perch there. And it just adds so much HP and attack that you're really at a huge disadvantage if you don't have high level gear.
Agree. Taco asked a question a little bit ago. I don't know if you mind sharing. How did you get on Angels and Demons? And she had mentioned it was before you were level 400, which is like kind of a big deal. So can you talk about that?
Yeah, so I was actually contacted by Dad from Angels and Demons because he had watched my YouTube channel, and he just sent me a message one time, and then I ended up talking to him a little bit, and ended up actually going to him and asking him if he could, and I wouldn't recommend this to other people. He doesn't take kindly to it, generally speaking, but I went to him and I asked for help getting better with Calivor, and I sent him a couple videos and he gave me some tips. And then from there, we just started talking, and he knew that I was potentially looking for a team. I left Vikings for another team that I didn't end up thinking was a very good fit, and so I didn't stay there very long, and I was you know, kind of looking for another team. And I had a couple of invites from strong teams. I think one of them was a generic invite that United in Honor had sent me. So I was strongly considering that. Then, you know, I was in a one of Taco's in-game chats, and we were sort of pestering Tinbrew about, you know, what level would I have to be to get in. And from there, you know, I guess Dad messaged the leader of Angels and Demons and, you know, talked to him about it. And then I somehow ended up getting an interview to get in there. And I was a 388 at the time. And I think their lowest at that point was maybe like a 470 something. So I didn't think that was going to happen, but I am very active. And I think they, you know, looked at my kills and stuff and saw that, like, and I made it clear, like, they were more concerned that I wasn't going to be happy about mostly, like, defending. I couldn't really join our raids because they're against max bases most of the time. So they were making sure that I was going to be happy doing that, and you know, that it was going to be difficult for me to find targets, which it was at first, difficult to find targets for good glory. But yeah, somehow they liked me, I guess, and they let me in. So it's been a really good fit, I think.
Awesome. Thank you for sharing that. I want to open it up to you guys, the viewers. Do you have any questions besides can Prime show his ankles? We'll give them a second.
Okay.
Oh my gosh.
But yeah, to clarify, like, earlier, we are in Sapphire 3 right now, but, like, most people know, like, we are a diamond team, like, structured as a diamond team. It's just, you know, the game doesn't really make it worth it to move up leagues. And, like, our focus is Atlas, so it doesn't really matter as much. We get a lot of, like, daily egg tokens from Atlas anyways, so a lot of people just aren't going to put in, like, a ton of extra effort and resources to get, you know, the rain back from the event.
Someone just said, give us some more tips, Prime. But they didn't specify anything.
So I don't know if I have any great tips. Don't get hit by ice flax. My biggest, I think I've given like my favorite tips. But like as far as like flying tips, they're very dragon specific, so I couldn't really give too much there. Most of my Atlas tips I've already given, but an Atlas tip is find, and sometimes they actually don't show up, but if you find a castle that you want to hit, see if you can find the where their Primarch is surrounding the castle, and click on that to attack rather than going through the menu. It saves you some time. I find that useful, but sometimes they don't show all of them, so you can't do that. Dad asked a question in there asking me who my favorite A&D backer is, and that would, of course, be Dad, because he backed me primarily, like a lot of my runs when I first joined.
Aww.
So
supported you.
Yes. He made my glory possible, because I definitely needed a backer for a lot of my early runs. So he helped a lot with that. I get backed by a lot of people actually still, just because I'm still hitting up. One legendary Verdant is pretty close, but if you're getting double defended on max bases, you definitely are going to struggle on 117 towers. And pretty much all the bases I hit are 117s now. It's very helpful. It's nice to see that. And, most of the team joins my runs and is very supportive. So
sounds like a good person to have in leadership of your team.
Favorite War Dragons YouTuber, I would probably say is Taco. She puts a lot of effort into her videos, I feel. I know that because I put in, some effort, but I'm not, making it. I don't put a ton of effort into editing. I feel like my main goal is to get out attacks and information and stuff, but I don't worry about the editing as much and make it pretty. But she does a very good job. And Pineapple, I used to love pineapple on pizza, but I haven't had pineapple on pizza in a very long time. I actually have broccoli on pizza a lot.
Is it roasted broccoli or not roasted? What are we talking?
either or.
I think I could do roasted.
Roasted I'm sure is good as well.
Pepperoni knows I love pineapple on pizza, but I haven't had pineapple on pizza in a long time either. But I do like it a lot.
A lot of these questions are interesting. Let's see. Who do you dislike most on A&D? That's a good question to answer. Do I have plans for next season? I'll answer that one. So my plans for next season are to open my chests. I was playing on playing around with that before stream, how I'm going to go about opening my chests, because I actually need eggs. And so I was looking at it. If I opened up all of my stuff during breeding, I would get an extra almost, I think it's almost 100,000 difference. Let me actually see. So if I opened everything, I think I'd get 197,000 egg tokens on average in PvP. And then breeding, it would be 306,000. So I was considering it, but I would lose out on a lot of PvP resources, so it's kind of questionable, especially now that Draconics are kind of up in the air, so it depends on what happens with Draconics. But either way, I'm going to get both discounts during the two-week discount, and I'll get those and get off to a good start for the Mythic Hunter. That's my plan, I think, so far, is to try to get that Mythic Hunter as quickly as possible and start learning how to fly him.
Do you generally just go for one Mythic a season?
Yeah, I've never even gotten close to two. That would take a lot. There's probably very few people that get two Mythics in a season. And we also get, like, a lot of rewards as a team, and I do well in events, generally speaking. I've been on a good stretch. I think I've been top 25, like, three events in a row global, so...
That's amazing.
I definitely will fall way off this PvP, but, I do well in events, so I get a lot of sigils, too, I've never been close. Also, though, I guess this season and the previous season, I did use sigils to get a ton of draconic chests, so... I guess if that wasn't the case, I'd have to run it through a calculator, but I highly doubt that I would be anywhere close to a second Mythic.
What else? I don't know.
Thank you to BKB for recruiting me. I just saw that one. he actually knew me from... I had an alt at the time. I stopped playing it because I just, I played during the day, and then most of the time, like, I really play is at nighttime after my son goes to sleep. That's, like, the time I have. He knew me from my alt team. We Live for War. I was on there. So that's where I knew him from, and he just, I guess, saw me in the chat. He's like, hey, are you this guy? And so then... he ended up bringing me in, thank you to BKB.
Awesome. Do we have any other questions?
Am I a bot? No, I am not. Let's see. Do I grind egg token missions? You know what? I used to grind them a lot, and I haven't done that in quite a while. And I probably should, because I really need egg tokens this upcoming breed. I don't remember what I'm at, but I definitely... I have to breed two more legendary Verdants, which I think is about 500,000 egg tokens, in order to start the Mythic. And I want to start the Mythic because I have Mystic Fragments to use as well, and those will get me, I believe, to the 700,000 prize. Usually like to get that, and so I probably should start grinding them a little more, but I've just been spending my time in Atlas, which, you know, doing those Atlas missions, because I'm active in Atlas, I have the mission tokens, so I don't actually have to have dragons that qualify. So I'm constantly using old dragons with standard riders to do the 5-star mission, 4-star mission, and 3-star mission. Occasionally I'll run out and have to go down to one of the other ones for one of them, but lately I've just been doing the 5, 4, and 3, like, around the clock, and so those add up to a decent amount too. But yeah, I will have to start grinding some, I think.
So Grumpy Bird's got a couple good questions. Who's the hardest base you've ever hit?
So that's a tough one because I haven't hit it very many times. Let me see if I can check on my phone real quick the name, because yeah. the other way I know this person is probably not the way I'll bring it up. Let's see. So I've attacked. Now, this probably isn't actually the toughest base, but I'm just going based off Atlas because I haven't hit a ton of bases that are like fully maxed, full length bases. I thought this one was really difficult because I hit it the other day in Atlas. And I don't know how you even say this, but it's a 653 on Royal Road. It's like KUWACYAN. Its defense power is 106 billion, and they have 19% damage reduction for dark. So hitting that with Calivor was extremely difficult. And fortunately, I had a backer. That was good because the first time I didn't, and it didn't go as well. I still beat it, but it did not go well.
Have you hit that person again to try to master it?
No. Outside of the way I hit them before, they would countersight me.
Okay.
So, yeah, I have not. I've hit other bases in Atlas to practice, because I don't know if, like, a lot of people have, like, some of the lower levels wouldn't have tried, most likely, but, like, well, couldn't try, I guess, because they wouldn't be maxed out. But if you're going into, like, a fully maxed base that's 117 starting at 8, you'll realize, like, especially in Atlas, like, all of the islands are very different. So, like, starting at 8 for me is kind of difficult, and I have a hard time with it. So I've been hitting some max bases that start on 8 to try to get better at it. But I'm also just a little underpowered. If they don't have a dark totem, that 19% debuff is helpful enough where I can get through pretty easily if it's undefended. If it's got a dark totem and it's 117s the whole way through, like 100 billion, I have a hard time with it because I struggle. Like, I can get 8 perfectly fine, and then I sort of run out of steam on 7 because I'm also trying to conserve so that I'll have some rage left for Island 6. So that's why I struggled a lot with that base because my firepower is just a little low.
That's awesome.
That's definitely the hardest I've hit in Atlas. There's other bases I've hit in main game that are on the same level. Once you get up over 100 billion, the layout doesn't matter quite as much. I mean, it does. If you're getting defended, the layout matters a lot. But undefended, I don't think layouts have, like, a huge, huge impact because, like, you know, people can just waste your super shots that the AI chooses. So, like, a lot of times people will trick the AI into using super shots on, like, mages. They'll leave a mage up and just keep, you know, avoiding that super shot. And then, you know, the ice flak can't hit you, and the earth flak won't go off and stuff like that. So it's... The layout really only matters a lot defended. But they're still harder. You know, if they have a cosmic, I guess that makes it significantly harder. I still struggle with those, so.
Do you think that the cosmic aura was, like, an awesome new addition for War Dragons to change things up and change the meta?
So, I do think it was kind of... It was a lot easier to attack before it, in my opinion. I definitely think it's too strong. It just does too much. Like, it prevents rage generation. It speeds you up. It protects other towers. It's got high HP. It's just got it's got a lot going for it that make it pretty overpowered. So, that being said, I have one on my base, so I wouldn't be super happy if they nerfed it, but I know some people have been calling for that.
So this is kind of a segue. One person, Taco, asked, do you think Sepala is pretty? And then Fire asked, how much do you dislike Sepala fires? So do you have some thoughts on Sepala?
So I've never flown Sepala, but I think it is a pretty dragon. I've never flown it, but I know, you know, a lot of people hate on Sepala because it was really bad at the beginning of the last season. But then, you know, after buff, it was actually a really good dragon. But a lot of people had already made their decision, so that's why not a lot of people have it. But I think it's a very good looking dragon.
I had a really hard time deciding last season. It was the dragon. I loved its look, and I ended up not getting it. But
so yeah, it was a very easy dragon, because the margin of error was you could make a lot of mistakes. So the margin of error was lower. If you make a couple of mistakes against like good bases with Calivor, you're just done, but you have like a little extra room with Sepala. Also, you know, you kind of have a lower ceiling with Sepala as well, though.
Grumpy wants to know, what's the most exciting thing to happen to you in War Dragons?
Most exciting thing to happen to me? I don't know exactly what I would say the most exciting thing to happen to me was. Like I said earlier, the most exciting moment I had was probably when we conquered the T5. But for me personally, I was kind of excited earlier because I landed a very very small 500 troop snipe on But We Are Better. So I was pretty happy with that, but just because it's been something I've talked about, landing one on them for a long time. Now it was only 500 troops, so they probably just didn't care, but I was still happy with it.
Taco asks, what's the worst part and or like most challenging part of War Dragons?
So the most challenging part is getting through the early levels to me. Until you break through like level 100 or so, the game is kind of slow and it's difficult. I remember running XP run after XP run on Etten, and I just could not get that thing breedable on my alt. And so finally I was just like, all right, I'm skipping breed. Past the one dragon, so I just stopped because it was so frustrating. It was going to take, you know, just running that for hours on end. So I would say once you get past like green tier specifically, I remember green tier being particularly painful. It's much better. That's probably the most frustrating thing. Early quits are frustrating, but hopefully those aren't going to happen to me now because I'm on 1-2. So if they early quit, they're quitting before they get to the percentage on my base. Unless they early quit after farms, and then, you know, that's going to get them like 10% or something.
You'll have to give us some kind of update now that you've changed your base like this. Like, I definitely would have interest in knowing if it's working out or not.
Yeah, so I can tell you so far, I believe the only counter on me has been Kralos and Veebled that has landed. But, you know, if somebody, you know, is right there when I start attacking, they'll probably still beat me because I still have to, like, the bases I attack are almost always at least, like, 3 or 4 islands of 117s or 115s or, you know, something around there. And so those are going to take me more time to get through than, like, you know, my level 1 towers on the way. I really have to have like a slight head start, but usually like when you're sniping, if you aren't very obvious about it, like if you don't like go from 5 minutes away to no man's land in front of their castle, you know, you have a better chance. So if you're sneaky about it, I think you'll have a slight head start that usually is probably enough. But I will let you know, I think it's going to be helpful anyways to avoid early quits, because when they could quit after Island 4 for me, I just didn't stand a chance if they had people online and I was going by myself.
King Bran asks, how much ahead of time do you plan your fort and or breeding events, and do you know when you'll get endgame towers?
So I didn't go that far ahead, actually. I normally do plan these things very, very far out, and like I'll look at what rewards I'm gonna get from like the whole season, like, you know, gradually, like, okay, so I'll claim, you know, in breeding I'll get this many prize tiers, that'll add up to this many timers, add those to my timer count for that fort, and then I'll run it all through the fortification planner, which is extremely helpful. If you haven't heard of that, you can find a link on the forums, but it's just a fortification planner. Sorry, one second.
No problem.
Just a fortification planner that you can enter all of your information in on, and you know, it tells you how many levels you can gain, how many points you'll score, and
the spreadsheet.
Yeah, the spreadsheet. Yeah. And looking at it kind of pains me, because every time I see it, I remember that I don't have platinum research for construction time. But anyways.
I'm with you. I got super behind on that for some reason. I just stopped it because I wasn't willing to give up egg tokens for it. And then I just totally forgot about it.
So that's my thing. Progression is more important than that stuff to me. So I weigh progression over like almost all things in the game, because... that's just something that means more to me. So I put progression first, and so I'm like not even done with green research, and I've done like some past green to try to get to some like things that I thought were important for me, but I still haven't finished. So,
totally in the same boat as you.
Yeah. But yeah, I do plan very far in advance. Like, I know what I'm going to get this breed. And then it's hard to plan past that because, breeding is hard because it's hard to plan how many you're going to, like, eggs I'm going to get, because it can vary so much. You know, like, I get egg tokens from Atlas lines and stuff like that. And then, you know, it depends how well you do in all the events. And I try not to make the decision on PvP events beforehand. Sometimes I like to make the decision based on, like, you know, if they release, if I'm low on sigils and they release like a rune, like this upcoming PvP, there's going to be a limited time branch that I believe they said was a rune. So, you know, I'm a little low on sigils. If that's really good, maybe I'll put forth a lot of effort in the PvP event. I think I've gone on record saying I hope it's not very good, because I don't want to really get a lot in this PvP event. I just don't I don't feel like it this time around, and fight pits isn't my favorite either, so it's hard to do that, but I definitely do at least one out, and I try to, you know, I run things through, like, I don't know if people know of the event chest drops spreadsheet. It's not, you can enter how many chests you're going to open in what event, and it'll tell you, you know, how many sigils, egg tokens, mystic fragments, powers of speed ups, all that stuff. That's been very helpful, because, you know, a lot of people say not to open during certain events, and you know, I've opened plenty in fortification events. I've opened gold chests in fortification events. Now, granted, that was after opening Draconics. So Draconics have so many PvP resources that maybe if I was struggling on those resources, I wouldn't have opened them during fortification. But elemental embers get extremely expensive to keep leveling once you get towards the higher level towers. So if I didn't open any golds, I wouldn't be able to level. So along the way, I've opened some golds in fortification. I don't think I've opened in breeding, which I mentioned thinking about because I get an extra 100,000 egg tokens. Surprisingly, though, you actually get more fragments. You actually get like twice the mystic fragments if you open them during PvP, but you get way less egg tokens. I just thought that was interesting that you wouldn't get more egg tokens and mystic fragments. But yeah, like, so I pretty much just plan chest opening stuff for the discounts. I definitely plan breeding, but I have like a sort of plan, but you know, it really depends how many I have, but I have a general idea of what I'll be able to get to. And then fortification, I plan very heavily. This one I actually went over because I did some daily or some trading post timer deals and stuff to get an extra couple upgrades in and stuff. So I went a little past what I was planning just because, well, it's really just like an OCD related thing, because it bothered me that I had a couple of towers that weren't 110s. And so I just wanted like the base to be slightly stronger. I know 110s aren't that strong for like my opponents, but you know, I had like, I think when I was sort of done getting to like the level I wanted to get to and should have probably stopped, maybe, I had, I had like 4 110s. I just prioritized like towers that I thought were most important. So I had like 4 110s and the rest were like, you know, 107s and 108s. And I just decided to clean it up a little bit and make them 110s. Because at this point, my farms and mills are quite a bit behind too. So I believe I could get to the like later fortification prizes just upgrading farms and mills as well as like my regular towers without having to do that much in terms of timers. So that kind of weighed on that. I didn't touch my farms or mills that whole past fortification.
Someone was asking about your favorite PvP. So what's your favorite, what's your least favorite, and then also thoughts on Kingdom Wars being shelved and something new coming.
So my favorite is probably, I want to say Team Gauntlet. Temple Raid would by far be my favorite and will be once they come out with the raid button. But my team opens a ridiculous amount of guardians, and I don't know if your team does or not, but like once you get to, you know, your 50th time running those guardians, it's pretty tedious. So that's the only reason I wouldn't say Temple Raid, and I would say Gauntlet. I don't like fight pits very much. It's just not that interesting. Kingdom Wars, I'm happy it was shelved. I didn't like that event. Crystal Caves, it remains to be seen if that's going to be a good event. They haven't actually given us anything interesting about Crystal Caves, like telling us anything about it really other than it's PvP. But I am looking forward to a change. Hopefully, you know, they can, it sounded like they were trying to do it the right way and release it as like a test slowly as like a minor event. So that, you know, if it's done as a bonus event, people can't get that upset if it, you know, doesn't work properly. So it's better than just them, you know, pulling a Kingdom Wars and just, you know, making changes and going live and hoping for the best. So I'm, you know, hopeful that Crystal Caves will end up being good.
Yeah, I'm hopeful too. And excited for something new.
At least I think that's what it's called. I could be wrong.
Crystal Caves, yeah. All right, I think that's all the questions that have come up.
Let's see. Let me see if I see anything. Yes, fire did take some of the fire away from me earlier to allow me to hit a couple of targets. Yeah, I think that's about it for this, for the questions I've had so far. Dreadnought or Butley are better. Well, I'm on one side, so I'd say that side. And I do think they're better, actually, but yeah.
Someone said Butt Prime is better.
That's true. I you know, if we ever fight them, I should change my name to that.
There you go.
But not a bad idea. Although I don't know that we'll do that anytime soon.
Alex the Wolf said, still waiting for a video, Prime, which I'm not sure if you weren't here earlier. He is going to get back to posting YouTube videos sometime in the near future.
Yes, yes. My wife actually was on like a very long vacation around Christmas for like a few weeks. And so I was just spending time with her and my son. And so I haven't gotten back into the habit of, you know, recording and making the videos yet. But I did just, and I had some device issues because my phone was very old, and when I turned on record, I had about, like, you know, 3 minutes before it got to, you know, the temperature of my oven. So, and then, like, didn't function. So, I did just get another phone, so now I should be able to record no problem. And so I'll start making some videos again, hopefully soon. And, yeah, so... Do you know where this ankle deal originated?
No. I don't know who started it this stream, but somebody started it, and they've all just been running with it. So I thought it was like an inside joke you guys had or something.
Not that I'm aware of. It might be in one of my chats that I haven't read yet, because I haven't been on since before the stream. So
I was imagining maybe you like shared a picture or something, and like, you know, somebody like found something weird to compliment you on.
Not that I'm aware of.
Yeah, Pep thought it was a team thing. So I just thought you guys were all about it.
From Fire, she says. Or
it was me. You're welcome. Okay, Fire.
Well, interesting nonetheless.
Yes, it's been cracking me up this whole time.
Yes, I had seen it many times, and I was just I found it amusing, but I didn't know where that originated.
I didn't either.
But yeah.
So thanks for the entertainment, you guys. Thank you so much for your time and being on the stream with me. Again, I can't wait to hear about how your base setup goes. I definitely want to talk to you about that whenever time is good to have figured out if that's a great setup or not.
Yeah, I'll update you. A lot of my teammates actually have done that as well. And I was just hesitant because I never... like to spend my rubies because I always use that stuff for progression,
right?
Like I said, I put that first, so I was very hesitant, and then I just decided to do it because you know, it's kind of frustrating if you get countered a lot, and I actually don't get countered that often because I try to be smart about it, but like when and who I'm hitting, but I still get countered sometimes, so I know it works out well for a lot of them and allows them time to get their attacks off. So I decided to make the change, and I think it's going to work really well, but I will let you know.
Awesome. Thank you so much. And again, thank you so much for your time today and willingness to be on and answer a bunch of questions. And it sounds like everyone in the community loves you. So know that you are loved.
Thanks, guys. And thank you for having me. It's been fun.
Absolutely. Thank you again. And I'm sure we'll host you again someday.
Sounds good.
Okay, take care. Bye. Bye, everybody.